Welcome to lesson 6. In this lesson I'll explain how networking is organized in a Kubernetes environment. You'll learn about the three different layers of networking. Next I'll explain how networking within a pod functions, and you'll learn about pod-to-pod networking as well. So let's talk about Kubernetes networking. Kubernetes networking happens at three different levels. There is networking between the containers within a pod. There's networking between the pods, and apart from that, there's the external exposure of services. So the Kubernetes networking needs, what exactly is it? Well, we have a need to connect pods to other pods across nodes. That's what we call east-west traffic. There is a need to do service discovery and load balancing as well. And there is a need to expose services for external clients. And that's what we call north-south traffic. And last, there is a need for segmenting networks to increase pod security. And all of these needs have a different requirement for networking. Now, let's talk about intra-pod communication requirements. The challenge is that communication between pods happens without NAT. NAT is network address translation, and network address translation means that is what is happening within a pod goes through a network address translator. And network address translation for intra-pod communication is bad. You cannot have any NAT. And that imposes the requirement that all nodes running pods can communicate to all other nodes running pods without NAT. So nowhere in your network setup you can have network address translation, with the exception of the traffic that is coming into the pod. I will explain it in my upcoming whiteboard drawing. So there is no IP masking, and the IP that the pod sees is the same as how other pods see it. This also means that there are specific challenges running Kubernetes networking in cloud environments. Because in a cloud environment, typically, the IP that the cloud instance sees is not the same as the IP how other pods see it. In a typical configuration, the nodes hosting the pods are in their own network. So that would be a network like 192.168.1.0/24. The pods often are in an isolated subnet like 10.1.0.0/24. And the host, as well as the pods, should be able to directly connect to all others involved without NAT. So you must be very careful in setting up routing, and you must make sure that the pods, as well as the hosts, are capable of resolving all routes to all networks. Let me make a drawing on the whiteboard to explain this in a little bit more detail. So let me draw a quick overview picture of Kubernetes networking. Let's say we have a public network, and on the public network we have two worker nodes. Then your situation in networking may be as follows. The worker nodes, of course, have their own network. Let's say 192.168.1.1, and let's say the other one is 192.168.1.2. Obviously, these IP addresses make it possible for the nodes to communicate to one another. Next, within these nodes, we have the pods. And these pods have their own networking. The only requirement is that the pods are capable of directly communicating to one another as well as to the nodes. So you need to involve some routing as well. So you could say that this is 1.1.1.1 and this is 1.1.1.2, where this pod, these pods may use a different networking like 1.2.1.1 and 1.2.1.2. And as long as you have set up routing correctly, this is going to work. This is also what you will encounter when you explore the networking that is created in a Minikube environment, for example. Now let's talk about networking within a pod. Within the pods, containers communicate directly to one another. And this is internal communication, which is handled by Docker, as Kubernetes uses the pod as the lowest level entity. So the networking within the pod is not handled by Kubernetes at all, something important to consider in your design. Docker offers host private networking, where a virtual bridge with the name Docker Zero is created. And for each container that Docker creates, a virtual Ethernet device is created, and this virtual Ethernet device is attached to the bridge. The virtual Ethernet device really is the glue outside of the container that connects the container to the bridge. It's like a virtual Ethernet cable, in fact. The ETH0, which is the name of your network card typically within the container, uses an IP address from the Docker Zero bridge address range. And as a result, Docker containers can communicate to one another only if they are on the same host. Well, they have to be, because containers in a pod cannot be spread over multiple hosts. An important thing to realize is that this network communication within the pod is completely independent of what you are doing in your Kubernetes networking. This is configured on purpose using network isolation through namespaces. There are some other communication options within the pod as well. As containers within a pod really are processes running on the same host, they can find each other via localhost. And as a result, other standard POSIX interprocess communication methods do work as well, like System5 semaphores or POSIX shared memory. Let me show you how networking within the pod is organized. So I'm using Minikube SSH to connect to my Minikube host and brctl show. So brctl show is showing the bridge, which is Docker Zero, and all of the interfaces currently connected to the bridge. All of these interfaces represent a container, a Docker container, and currently I have quite a few Docker containers that are running. Let's type Docker PS, where you can see all of these different containers. The only issue that I want to show you here is there are many containers, and these many containers match the virtual Ethernet drivers that show in brctl show. Now, these containers have their own IP addresses. So let's do Docker PS again, and let's find a container like this one, which is one of the Nginx's. And if we do a Docker, inspect on the container, then we can see everything happening within the container. And if we go all the way down, then we can see network settings, which includes the current IP address, which is empty. So apparently this container is not currently running. That's possible. Do it on a running container and you will see the IP address. Now, if we type kubectl, and in order to do so, I need to get out of the Minikube machine. So kubectl get pods dash o white, then kubectl shows the IP addresses that are assigned by the Kubernetes environment. And that by default is happening in the 172.17 IP address range. And this IP address range is used by pods. So what is happening within the pod between the containers is completely independent of what you see here. In this lesson, we are going to talk about pod-to-pod networking. In order to organize pod-to-pod networking, there's the CNI. CNI provides plugins that implement pod-to-pod networking. And these plugins can be used at three different levels to implement three different types of networking. There is layer 2 networking, which is the easiest solution, which is based on switching. There's layer 3 networking, which is all about routing. And it can be overlay networking as well. You would use overlay networking if you need to create something that looks like software-defined networking. CNI layer 2 configuration can be quite easy. If you want to do that, then the pods and nodes see subnets that are used for pod IP addresses as a single layer 2 domain. That is as if you are plugging computers to the same physical network, and all of the computers can see each other directly. In order to communicate, it's LAN communication basically. So the pods and the nodes communicate by using ARP, the Address Resolution Protocol, which is a generic protocol that is used in all IP-based networks. In layer 2-based networking, you need a bridge plugin. So we have a named KubeNet type bridge. The bridge is Kube bridge, and the default gateway is set to true. And then we have the IPAM configuration set to host local and the subnet as well. And you just need to make sure that this plugin exists on all of the physical Kubernetes hosts to create a layer 2 networking configuration. Layer 3 networking is significantly more complicated. You would need it because layer 2 configuration is not scalable. If you want to use scalability, then you should consider using routing. You remember the requirement is that the pods and the nodes are able to communicate to one another directly by using direct IP addresses. You cannot use NAT, which is network address translation, in Kubernetes pod-to-pod networking, but there is no restriction telling you that you cannot use routing. And that's exactly what CNI Layer 3 is about. To implement it, different plugins are available. The Flannel plugin is one of the most common plugins, but others exist as well. And if you want to get into this configuration, I would advise you to consult the documentation at kubernetes.io for more details. The third type of networking is the overlay configuration. In the overlay configuration, you also depend on plugins that you are going to use. Overlay solutions can be used to define the network completely in software and use encapsulation. That looks a lot like VPN, and it allows you to send packets from one pod to another pod. The idea in overlay networking is that you are going to define software-defined networking using tunnel interfaces. As I mentioned, the solution looks a lot like a VPN technology. In VPN, the client is remote, and between the client and the server, there is the internet. But VPN makes it appear as if the client is on the local network. And that's exactly the same in the CNI overlay configuration. In order to create something like that, you need to use a common encapsulation mechanism. VXLAN, GRE, and some other encapsulation mechanisms exist that help you realize this. You should realize that configuring pod-to-pod networking, especially if overlay configurations or routing is involved, is a complex topic. So in this course, we won't cover it in much more detail. I would advise you to consult the documentation at kubernetes.io for more information. But before moving over to the next topic, let me do a quick drawing on the whiteboard to show you common layout of networking in a Kubernetes environment. So we have previously seen how Kubernetes networking is set up from an IP address perspective. But what is happening in here? That's what we are going to fill in right now. So the minimal requirement is that you will have a bridge. So this bridge is a Linux software bridge that allows the different pods to communicate. On top of this bridge, you may have a Kube bridge as well. This may or may not exist, so let me draw it in one of these nodes only. And then the pods are going to connect to this interface using VETH. VETH is a virtual Ethernet cable. So the idea is that pod 1 is using a VETH to connect to the Kube bridge, and we have the same right here. It's like a virtual patch cable that is provided by the VETH devices. And you will actually be able to see all of these different components when you explore networking in a Kubernetes environment. The last tier of Kubernetes networking is about exposing services. So services are a different object in Kubernetes. And that is why I'm talking about services in much more detail in the next lesson. But for now, as they are a part of networking as well, I just want to briefly explain what services are about. So services are about exposing functionality externally. In order to do so, you need services. If you just bring up the deployment, nobody can access it. A service refers to a set of pods, which is based on labels. And services work with publicly accessible IP addresses. And as I mentioned, in the next lesson, we'll discuss services in much more detail. We are now at the end of lesson 6. In this lesson, we have talked a lot about networking. We haven't really configured anything, but let's do a lab anyway to explore how networking is organized. So in this lab, you are going to explore Kubernetes networking all the way down the stack and make sure to answer the following questions. These questions help you as a guideline to figure out how networking is organized. Which network devices does Kubernetes create on the nodes? Which network devices does Docker create on the nodes? Which IP addresses are used by your pods? And which IP addresses are used by the containers in your pods? Good luck. To answer the questions in this lab, we need to do a minikube SSH. Because networking all happens on the minikube node. Let me open a root shell. And from the root shell, let's start using brctl show. This is showing us that we have a bridge, and the bridge is Docker 0. And to the Docker 0, we have all the vETH interfaces. These vETH interfaces are virtual patch cables. Virtual patch cables that connect to the individual Docker containers. Now, if we want to have some more information about these Docker containers, then docker ps is the command to run. Let's do wc, and there we can see that we have 47 Docker containers that are currently running. These Docker containers include some internal Kubernetes containers that you haven't created yourself, and they are replicated containers from within the pods as well. So the Docker PS result is much more than what you see from kubectl get pods. Now, if you want to explore networking within a container, then we can use Docker inspect. Now, if you do Docker inspect, we need the Docker ID of the container. So let's just pick one of these containers so that I can show you the example. So I'm copying the ID, I'm pasting it, and I see the contents. And in this contents, I can see in the last bit of the output that IP address is empty. Many containers do not have an IP address that is set within the container. And that is because in a Kubernetes environment, networking is set at the pod level and not necessarily at the container level. There are some exceptions though. Let me show you using for I in. And we are going to loop on the output of Docker PS, awk print $1, because in the Docker PS output, it is really the first field that matters. So in that output, we are going to do a Docker inspect minus F, which is the filtering option. And we are filtering out dot network settings dot IP address. Let's close the filter. Specify where we want to do that. We want to do that on $i, which is every Docker container. And let's close the loop using done. And there you can see some, but not all of the containers do have an IP address. And all of these IP addresses are within 172.17. And 172.17, well, that's an interesting range because this IP address range is also the IP address range that is used by the pods. Let's go out of the minikube machine and let's use kubectl get pods -o white to show the IP address. And here you can see that many of the IP addresses that have been displayed using the docker ps command are available as a pod IP address as well. many, but not all of them. And that depends how the pod is taking care of its business. And that is how you can explore networking in a Kubernetes environment.